have Dr. Victoria Marshall and Dr. Tom Kirkland here to talk to us about 50 years of scientific computing at the renowned Rocket Lab in Roxy. And various other members from RAL are here as well, including Ian Johnson, who's around here somewhere. Oh, yes. Yeah. I'm Simon Moss, I'm on the committee of the British Computer Society. I'd just like to flag up a couple of things. The talk in 2 weeks' time, which would have to be cancelled, it was the end of 21st of April, about gaming. That is currently taking place 2 weeks today here on the 26th, assuming it doesn't get postponed again, or Sheila's had no end of trouble getting this organised, so we have to hope it goes ahead. And then the dead cert on the 9th of June, which is a month today, I suppose, 4 weeks today, it's computing for the world water speed record with Nigel McKnight of the Quicksilver Project. So we have time for questions after the talk from Tom and Victoria. Or do you mind being interrupted during the talk?
I don't mind being interrupted.
Well, it's entirely up to you.
Might go on even longer if
we are. Okay. And I think without further ado, I'll hand over to Tom and Victoria.
Is Victoria Marshall, as you may have guessed, and I'm here with my colleague Tom Kirkham. We're both computer scientists from Rutherford Acton Laboratory. Tom is from the Scientific Computing Department, and I'm from the Central Laser Facility. But tonight, I'm here representing some of the extraordinary computing history that we have at the lab. While Tom is the youngster, we'll talk about some of the computing work that's going on now.
Okay, so we're
going to
get a little bit of a double axe.
Yeah, don't get double axe.
A bit like a sandwich on the thin slices of bread, but it's always the main bit in between with all the interesting stuff. So I'm trying to add a bit of context. If you've never been to a lab before, basically this is the site. The other half is Harwell, so we've got all these different bits on it. And scientific computing currently is in this building there, but the Atlas Centre is across the road. We're part of SDFC, which stands for the Science and Technologies Facilities Council, and we've got several sites across the UK. The site at RAL is the biggest, followed by the site at Darsby in Warrington, and these are the two main areas where we do most of our computer science. And we've also got laboratories at the bottom, Bolbury Potash Mines, and also observatories at Gibraltar, etc. So we do a lot of world-class research, largely in physics and life sciences. As this slide says, it's about 1,500 people who work for SDFC. And we work a lot of the time as part of international consortiums on different research projects or different ongoing scientific experiments. And we, over the last few years, particularly at RAL, we've expanded quite a bit in terms of the amount of buildings on the site relating to government policy around innovation campuses, etc. And we've also, as well, started up with more earnest engaging with younger people around the STEM areas of work, so that's science, technology, engineering, and maths. So in terms of our three sort of main facilities at the lab, we've got a neutron source called ISIS, which has got two parts to it, but effectively that does a lot of work into different materials, firing neutrons at them. Then we've got Wiratoria Works, which is the lasers. There's a lot of research firing lasers and things, so at the moment a lot of work is in plasma and this, is it nuclear fission or fusion? Yeah. I knew I'd get that one wrong. And then the other one is our latest experiment, which is a big one. If you've never been to the site before, it's about the size of a football stadium, and that's diamond, and that's like a really high-powered X-ray, it's a synchrotron, and that's the wide range of experiments, including dating ancient material and things like that. So all that high-grade scientific research, it's the same kind of research we was doing back in the 50s and the 60s, although that was more towards the nuclear side when they originally started looking into buying a computer to do the function of Atlas. And nothing's changed. We still support our science with computing, and it's still largely multidisciplinary. And due to the large computational demands that we have in our experiments, we do specialise in specific areas around data management, security, distributed computing, and also, importantly, visualisation. But Atlas was the first purpose-built facility for computing ever lab, and possibly within the world. It was the Atlas Centre is the size of a small supermarket to house a computer, and scientists have their own rooms, etc., etc. But I'll allow Toria to go into that detail. She can do a job 10 times better than me on that. So here we go.
Console of a Ferranti Atlas One computer. This computer is the biggest, fastest, most powerful, general purpose commercial computer in the world in 1964. Only three were ever built. The prototype was at Manchester University. The second machine was shared by London University and BP. The third, the largest and the most expensive at just over £3 million, was known as the Chiltern Atlas. That was sited at the Atlas Computer Laboratory next to what is now Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, which, as you now know, is where Tom and I both work, which is why Atlas is of some significance to us, even though neither of us are actually old enough to remember it. Atlas came into service on Thursday, the 8th of October, 1964. So 2014 was the 50th anniversary of its inauguration. We had a couple of celebratory events for that, and an exhibition featuring quite a few of our computing heritage items, including the Cray XMP, an IBM 360-195, and the Engineer's Console. There were literally tons of history there. It was great fun, and we barely got the Cray in through the door. But this evening, I'm just going to give you a very accelerated and very personal view of what I think is so interesting and so important about the Atlas computer. This is an aerial view of site, courtesy of Google Maps, of course. And if you'll notice, it's a long, straight road running just about east-west. That used to actually be a runway, because originally the site of Rutherford Lab and Harwell was an RAF base, RAF Harwell. Apparently it flew Wellington and Handley Page Halifax bombers, so I'm told. And it was also the starting point for some of the glider-borne troops that landed in Normandy D-Day. In 1946, just after the war had ended, the land north of the runway became AERE Harwell, the Atomic Energy Research Establishment. That was researching nuclear energy for the MOD. In 1957, the land south of the runway became the site of the Rutherford High Energy Laboratory. That was doing neutron research using the Nimrod linear accelerator, which was later developed into ISIS that Tom mentioned earlier. That was funded by NIRNS, the National Institute for Research into Nuclear Science. Now, nowadays, of course, you probably know that Rutherford Lab is in Oxfordshire. Back in the 1960s, it was in Berkshire. This was particularly and politically important because the locals were not at all certain about their atomics doing nuclear things at Harwell, so Rutherford needed to be seen as something separate. The silver donut is Diamond. That was opened in 2007. And just to the west of the little white blob, and about there, that was the site of the Atlas Computer Laboratory. Construction work for the Atlas Computer Laboratory started in 1962, and then faced one of the worst winters in living memory. The building was designed specifically to house the Atlas One computer, which was on order at the time and took 3 years to build. Rutherford's in-house magazine called Orbit ran an article about Atlas and the Atlas building, and it described it as of Scandinavian design. Perhaps this is the first laboratory to break away from the ponderous Victorian articles which encumber other government establishments. I just love the wording. Obviously, staff were needed for this new institute. A job advert at the time advertised, "We are looking for an exceptional man." Personally, I take exception to that, although I would point out there were quite a number of women who worked at Rutherford, sometimes often in very important scientific jobs. It advertised the salary as well. For a principal scientific officer, your salary would have been £1,970. Salaries have improved since then, but obviously not as much as we would like. The Atlas Computer Laboratory was opened for business in 1964. Under the directorship of Dr. Jack Hallett, that's in the middle, laughing. He was a very interesting man, a wonderful man, with a wacky taste for yellow socks and flowery shirts. But he made a point of getting to know all of his staff, and all would always often be walking around the building, finding out what they were doing and how they were getting on. He was actually a mathematician and numerical analyst, worked on the differential analyzer, Douglas Hartree. He also worked in the theoretical physics division of Harwell with Klaus Fuchs, who was later found to be a Russian spy. But he'd always been interested in automatic calculating machines, as they were called then. So he jumped at the chance to run the Atlas lab. And he was awarded a CBE for this in 1969. When he retired in 1973, the Atlas computer was shut down. So I think he retired because it was shut down, but that's what happened. And because we're in Oxford, I should say, he was a fellow of St. Cross College. The Atlas One computer itself was the result of a collaboration between Professor Tom Kilburn in the Department of Electrical Engineering at Manchester University, that's him there, and was built by Ferranti at their West Gordon workshop in Manchester. That was previously used to build steam railway locomotives, which meant there was soot everywhere. They had terrible problems with it getting everywhere. Tom Kilburn was a quiet and unpretentious guy. He loved music. He was a Manchester United fan. He was a mathematician and computer scientist and worked at what was then the Victoria University of Manchester. And he was building prototype computers, including the world's first stored program computer, the SSEM, a small-scale experimental machine, affectionately known as Baby, which of course was absolutely huge and weighed half a ton. He was elected an FRS, awarded a CBE, and became a distinguished fellow of the BCS in 1974. Now, in the brochure, the Atlas One computer is described by Ferranti, rather diffidently, I always feel, as one of two or three most powerful machines in the world today. The specifications vary, but our Atlas is described as having 48K ferrite core, or 1024 48-bit words, 8K of fixed store, 1K of working store, and 96K magnetic drum store. The manufacturers claim overall speeds of 700,000 instructions per second, but the reality is probably only half that. Now, as the brochure indicates, Atlas have various types of memory depending on what we want to do and what sort of access speed was required. This is a frame of ferrite core memory. There are 64 horizontal and 64 vertical wires with a magnetic donut-shaped core at the junction of each. So depending on the current supplied, you can magnetize this core clockwise or anti-clockwise, instantly giving you a form of binary. Now the advantage of this particular technology was that if all power was lost, your program remained in this memory, which is why this sort of technology was also used on many big Apollo missions. This is a giant photo. In reality, this thing is 12 centimeters square. So it's rumored that Plessy employed Spanish lace makers to make them. The Ferranti brochure goes on to say, the system operates on a thoroughgoing multi-programming basis. Around 200 jobs may be in the system at any one time, of which perhaps a dozen may be in the execution phase. This photo is of the operations room upstairs in the Atlas building. As you can see, there are lots of peripherals, including the Ampex magnetic drives along the back. There's a tape reader, a small printer, big printers here, card readers, and there's a card punch somewhere over there. Now the orchestration and scheduling of that hot was the job of the innovative supervisor program, which also managed the transfer of blocks of instructions between the core store and the drum as the program required. Nowadays, we call the supervisor the operating system, and this fast transfer of blocks of data in and out of memory, virtual memory, those first came into practical use in Atlas. By the way, while we're here, go to this side of the slide. Note the camera in the ceiling, and this camera monitor here. Come back to that in a second. Part of the ground floor of the Atlas building was the machine room, and as you can see, it was filled with cabinets. These are the power regulation cabinets. This is the console that we saw earlier. It's one of the engineers, his name is David Bowell. There's another printer and another paper tape reader there. Behind him is the fixed store cabinet, and you can just about make out it's a big room. Lots more cabinets of a CPU, peripheral control, and hard disks beyond. Now, if you remember the camera and the monitor upstairs in the operations room, there's a second camera in the machine room here, pointing down onto the console there. That image was fed upstairs so the operators could keep a check on what was happening to make certain the machine was running smoothly. And the camera in the ceiling of the operations room was focused on the mag tape drives, so that when the engineer was running the tests, he could watch what was happening here and check that all his tests were going correctly.
I want to think in the middle, that looks like an early flat screen display.
That one?
No, to the left.
Some of these buttons you can push and they do things that you use set the address into which your error code was deposited, if you miss anything. It's a wonderful thing. Now, this is an Atlas circuit board, or package as they were known. Atlas contained about 5,660 of these, with several hundred different types. All the components were hand-soldered, of course. No such thing as robots in those days. And if you're interested in electronics, I'm told that these things here are mullards, an early type of transistor based on germanium rather than master silicon technology. If you look carefully, you'll see these three little tags here. The colours and the sequence of colours identify the type of package that it was. And if you look even more carefully, you may or may not be able to tell, but these racks have little dots underneath them which correspond to the colours that were on each package. So you knew exactly which circuit board was supposed to go in which slot. Atlas was an asynchronous machine, everything ran autonomously. But there was a 100 nanosecond prepulse that constantly ran around the system. And if that prepulse was lost, you knew you were in trouble because something had broken. And when that happened, you had to get your oscilloscope, this handy portable piece of equipment you see in front of you, and then go from cabinet to cabinet and rack to rack, and sometimes circuit board to circuit board, testing your input signal and your output signal to try and find where the problem lay. Now, the phosphor on the scope screens at the time gave out a green glow. So the engineers had this wonderful little language. They talked about the little green man running through the system. And sometimes he ran the right way up, and sometimes he ran upside down. Apparently, sometimes he used to bump into a door and not be able to get through. But I am delighted to be able to tell you that Atlas is running correctly at the moment, because the pre-pulse light on the console is a nice, steady on. Atlas had 16 hard disks. That's one of those things there, the round thing, with a coffee mug in front of it to give you some idea of scale. They are 99 centimetres in diameter. We tried to get one here tonight, but it just wouldn't fit in the car. Each of these disks had a capacity of about 6 megabytes. The conversion from old to new is a bit dodgy, but it's about 6 megabytes. And you might just be able to make out that they spun in the cabinet. They spun horizontally. And all of the operators say they never dared open the cabinet when the disks were spinning, because if one of those things came off the spindle and flew out, that would be the end of you. Atlas was originally intended for use by the scientists at Harvard and Rutherford, but universities and other research institutes were encouraged to buy machine time at £800 an hour. So if you wanted to use Atlas, what would you do? Now, according to the Atlas User's Handbook, you would first need to register, of course, and you would be given a user number. For each job you wanted to run, you would need to estimate the Atlas time required in hours. The average time per job was about 3 minutes, but some could run for 24 hours, sometimes even 48, or over the weekend if you were doing some heavy number crunching. You also needed to tell them the number of lines of printer output you were expecting, so that if your program did get stuck in an infinite loop, it didn't eat three forests before someone realised. And of course you had to specify any mag tapes you wanted, printer facilities, tape readers, and so on. Several programming languages were available. This is extended Mercury AutoCode, the native language of the machine, if you like. I won't go into the details of this, just to give a flavour of what it looks like. This is Atlas AutoCode. That's some Atlas basic language. And there was a version of Fortran of Atlas called Fortran, as in R1 Fortran. And in the early 1960s, the scientific programming language was, of course, Fortran. IBM were quite happy to give a copy of their Fortran 2 compiler to the computing group of R1, but there were a couple of snags. Firstly, Atlas hadn't actually been delivered yet, so the compiler, which was itself written in Fortran, had to be compiled on the IBM 7090 at RISC. And secondly, IBM didn't have a formal specification of Fortran, so the whole thing had to be reverse engineered. That would have now it. Or you could choose to write your program in Algol. By 1963, Algol 60 had been available for a while and was a popular language for teaching in universities. Most universities had Algol compilers, so the challenge for the Atlas staff was to write a compiler that could cope with all the different dialects of Algol around the country, including the non-standard representation of I/O functions. Once you were registered and you decided on your language, you then had to write your program, probably by hand. Some universities had card punches, but a lot of them didn't, so you had to write your program by hand on one of these programming sheets, which is really green, pale green. This photo is a bit faded. You then send your programming sheets to Atlas, the Atlas lab, where it will be punched onto cards for you, sent up to the operations room, read, submitted to Atlas for execution, and the results posted back to you. If you are really lucky, you can get a turnaround time in under a week. Now, all jobs run on Atlas were logged by the Program Advisory Office, PAO. This was partly so the institutes could be invoiced for machine time at the end of the month, but also partly to keep track of jobs. This is a page from the PAO logbook, which they will recognise. It shows the user number, the user ID, their name, something about the job, and a date stamp when it was sent back to the user. This one is Atlas AutoCode. There are a number in Fortran. There's a Fortran here, mostly Fortran. If a job failed with a simple syntax error, then staff in the PAO could just retype the card and resubmit the job for you. But if a job failed with a more complex error, then they had to phone up the researcher and say, this has happened, what do we do? So there was some discussion about it. And by working very closely with scientists, the Atlas staff actually acquired quite considerable domain-specific knowledge themselves. By 1967, the breakdown of application types was 31% engineering, 22% mathematics, 18% physics, 12% chemistry, 5% medical and biological, 5% social sciences, and 7% other. I can't possibly tell you about all of them here, but I will tell you some of my favourites. This is Ariel 3. Ariel 3 was the first satellite designed and constructed in the UK. It was launched in 1967 from Vandenberg Air Base and had a tape recorder on board. It was conducting various experiments, including one to monitor thunderstorms across the globe in order to produce a world contour map relating noise levels to latitude and longitude. Arthur Hughes at Sheffield University used Atlas to analyse this data and you can actually see Ring Flair. You can actually see his jobs running through this book almost daily when he was analysing his results. Unfortunately, the tape recorder malfunctions soon after takeoff. So, data was only available when the satellite was actually overhead its base. Aero 3 was shut down and finally crashed to Earth in December 1970. But if you visit the Space Science and Technology Department of Earth and go into their visitor's centre, you'll be able to see a model of Aero 5, which was this one's younger brother. Aero 5 was launched a few years later. Atlas was used for quite a number of large-scale statistical surveys. This is one of a drawful punch cards we have from the NIRD, National Institute for Research in Dairying. You probably can't read it from there, but entries on the card include pathogen, antibiotic, and cow. I've tried to track down the purpose of the data and any results, but there's no name on these cards, there's no date, so it's proven to be a bit of a challenge. This sort of statistical analysis was of great interest to people, especially to Jack Howlett, who was actually a fellow of the Royal Statistical Society. And one of the programs written at Atlas was to assemble and analyze data and then store it on mag tape for future reference. You could then analyze this data by submitting punch cards of commands, such as, the manual does give an example, extract variable weight for animal 5064, from week 71 to week 104. In 1966, this was actually quite a sophisticated query, and this was actually a primitive form of database before databases had really been invented. Some years later, in 1971, Richard Peto, I think I pronounced that right, I'm not certain, and Malcolm Pike used Atlas to analyze data and prove one of the first links between smoking and cancer. The Met Office also used Atlas, and they developed a 10-level model to forecast rainfall, which, we're told, bore close resemblance to the rainfall patterns which actually developed. The only problem was it took 24 hours of computing to run it, so you couldn't really do daily forecasts. So in 92, they had to buy their own computer, which was an IBM 360-195, and they didn't need to use Atlas anymore. Because many universities didn't have computing facilities of their own, the Atlas Lab also provided a range of what were then hugely expensive and sophisticated plotters and printers. One of these was the Stromberg-Carlson SC4020. This was made by General Electric, who claimed it does the work of 25 men at half the cost. It was an extraordinary piece of equipment, but each of them cost £70,000 in 1967. So only a few dozen were ever constructed, and only three made it to this country. Two in Aldermaston, one in Rell. The key to this thing was a Carotron tube, which you can just about make out here. That worked much like a cathode tube, focusing an electron beam through a character matrix and onto a phosphor tube face with a camera above it, so you could film what came out. It was capable of drawing 10,000 vectors a minute, so it was used to produce some very complex diagrams. It was also used in the development of software for non-Western characters. This lady is Susan Hockey, now Emeritus Professor at UCL, and she produced a concordance of ancient scripts, including Arabic and Akkadian, which I had to Google, I must confess, it's ancient Mesopotamian. Now the SC4020 was supposed to be a microfilm recorder with a camera. But then people realized that because of its production speed, it can put a cine camera above it instead. You can do animations. In 1970, Alan Kitchen from the World College of Art and Gene Crow, the Atlas Lab, produced a film called Finite Elements. This was one of the first computer-generated engineering animations in the world. It was the first time engineers could really visualize the various problems that they had. This particular one used finite element analysis to model what happens when a heavy car drives over a bridge over the M6, which was being built at the time. The film also includes a simulation of the flow of effluent in the Solent as the two tides wash around each side of the Isle of Wight. And the sequence goes through various positions of the output. You can see what happens to said output. And I believe the final conclusion was they needed to move the output way down the coast. The Finite Elements had an optical soundtrack made by Peter Hadiman, who just scratched down the audio track, 35mm film. But in its day, this was completely innovative, and this film was the award-winning Great Britain entry in the International Technical Films Competition held in Moscow in October 1976. The Actors Lab also produced some film sequences for entertainment. Graham Stark's 1971 film, The Magnificent Seven Deadly Sins, included a pride segment by Alan Simpson and Ray Galton, with the animation produced using 4020. This was one of the examples used in the Tomorrow's World animation special, which was televised in September 1971. The reviews of the film are not altogether complimentary, but it's interesting because it's a precursor to the Goons and Monty Python. Other early animations included one that started with zooming in from outer space and then zooming up to the Atlas Lab, which is the building in the background. There were some early character animations involving Sylvester Squirrel, and some more serious output, including a series of films called Change and Chance, which described the second law of thermodynamics. There was also a series of films which formed part of an Open University course on mathematics. Just for fun, does anyone recognise this?
You turn the brakes off, and that alien landing sequence. Is that what it is?
I didn't think anyone would get that. I was going to give more hints. Well then.
Is it the alien?
Pardon?
Is it the
alien?
Yep. Not find it on YouTube. I tried today.
I recorded it on Saturday and very carefully paused at all the right moments just to check it really was there, and yes it is. This was done by Brian Weisel and quite a number of other people for Ridley Scott in 1976. So it didn't use Atlas, but it was done at the Atlas Lab using the FR-80, which was the successor to the SC-4020. It is a bit blinking and miss it, you have to know what you're looking at, but it's there, these images, a series of them, appear on the ship's monitors as it comes into land on the planet. The Chiltern Atlas computer was closed down on Friday the 30th of March 1973. Over 10 years in service, it had processed 836,000 jobs, run for 44,500 hours with a 97% uptime, although operators say double considerably less. It had read 300 million cards, read 4 billion characters from paper tape, produced 800 million lines of line printer output, punched 17 million cards, and supported 2,300 university projects. Boys, Atlas could sing as well. That's another story. So I have a few Atlas artifacts with me, if anyone is interested to see them afterwards. And At the top, there's a URL to the Children for Computing website, which I help maintain, with considerable expertise from my old department head, Professor Hopwood Ovie, who was there when all this happened, and he loves talking about Atlas even more than I do. I'll now hand us back to Tom to bring us into the question.
Thanks, Doris. So this is our current computer centre. It is called R89, and it's not quite Scandinavian design, but we've got open plan offices and air conditioning. this is a brief section. I'll give a quick overview of what we're doing in scientific computing nowadays. So we've got about 180 people working in the department, and we do a lot around data and high performance computing and visualization, as I mentioned at the beginning. Some of our facilities are the Jasmine Super Data Cluster, which is working largely with the National Environmental Research Council on several projects around atmospheric sciences of Earth observation. So there's a collaboration going on with that one. And then a major bit of our work is the Tier 1 to the, what's it called, the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider in CERN. This stores a huge amount of data from CERN in a petabyte range, and the Higgs boson bit of data, which was used for its detection, it was on that rack there. So there's a, you go in our machine room, there's a rack with a note on it saying this is where the Higgs boson was detected. On a more practical level, what I do in the group I work in, we do a lot of work around data management and data storage. We've got a large amount of cataloging software that we've developed to store a lot of the scientific data called TopCat and iCat, and quite a few of them is related to cats. So that's RAL. There's also a visualization suite at RAL, which is in the old Atlas Center, in the old cloakroom room. And at Darsby, we've just had a recent investment in computing around this kind of popular area of research into big data. So that's Darsby, located in Warrington. And central to that is this center called the Hartree Center, named after Douglas Hartree, who Victoria mentioned earlier on in the talk. That's been given quite a few grants from the government, and it's a partnership with IBM looking at big data. And it's designed to work hand in hand with industry, so there's a lot of partnerships, especially in the northwest around GlaxoSmithKline and that kind of industry, looking at data analytics and data visualization. So thank you for listening, and more importantly, thank you, Victoria, for giving us a very good overview about this. If you want any more information, just email us on these email addresses. Victoria's website is fantastic. The videos that she mentioned earlier are on the website, and lots of other resources as well. So thank you.
Okay, questions, anyone?
On the last slide, you mentioned cognitive computing. Can you say a bit more about that?
I could try. I think it's related to IBM Watson, which is, I think Brian might want to tell me out more with this one, but effectively, IBM have got put a lot of time and research into this software suite called Watson, where it learns from previous experiences. So the idea is you can go into your doctor and you can come up with a bunch of symptoms. Talking to a doctor, you can talk to Watson, which will then therefore detect keywords in your natural language, etc., and then try and figure out what was wrong with you. Is that a fair explanation?
So there's a partnership with IBM at the Hartree Centre. IBM are establishing a research centre there, and one of the major themes is cognitive computing, which I see as a mixture of kind of machine learning, and sort of intelligent assists combined with big data and high performance computing. And so they're looking at applications of that in, as I mentioned, in medicine, in drug design, in chemical design, all sorts of things.
But not neuroscience?
If you go and talk to them about neuroscience, I'm sure that they'd be very interested to use it in neuroscience, yes.
Oh, I would imagine they could cover that.
Yes. I don't know if there's any product in neuroscience at the moment.
I can get the artifacts out as well if you like. Okay, well, talk to us. Yeah, did you have a question?
Did this Cullum Science Centre integrate it with your places here, or is it separate?
Is Cullum part of SDFC? No. We do work with them to some extent, but.
We back up a lot of their data and vice versa.
Yeah.
And we collaborate with them on other European projects.
Yeah.
When we talk about Science Vale UK, whatever it's called around here, what does that encompass in totality?
Science
Vale UK is the sort of buzzword in this area.
Okay.
Which I assume my thought was like, oh well, and that brotherhood and colour.
It is.
I think, yeah, at least around the data, obviously there's a lot of collaboration around that. I know on the Harwell campus, it's a kind of a cluster area, so there's lots of SMEs and startups being located there, and I presume that they link into technology from, you know, the different centres such as Cullum as well, which is around the area. And there's lots of business breakfasts and things like that, you know, this kind of thing where people share knowledge and experience.
It's also quite a key area for cryo-technology. For some reason, a lot of cryo-businesses centred in the area, and someone in the technology department is very interested in this.
It's a little known fact that the search engine was invented in Harwell in 1968, and it was commercialised some years later on mini computers.
Status?
Yes.
I worked on Status.
I was actually wondering whether there was any rivalry between Harwell and Rutherford sites. And mainframe and mini sites, maybe, in the 1970s. And if such an important invention was discovered today, would it be better commercialised than Harwell might have been?
Well, I can't comment on the 1970s. Some of my colleagues might have a bit more insight into that.
Before my time.
Yeah, sorry. I think generally we collaborate on things between the two sites. I think, well, my recollections, and this is based on 10 years, really, the last 10 years, is, you know, Harwell, what distinguishes Harwell from Ramos Defence, because obviously there's a lot of nuclear material on that side, so it was harder to get access. I think, in terms of computation, is generally put over the fence to our side to do a lot of the processing, like Tori did with her, showed me a lot of the logs from the Atlas computer. But I presume, in terms of competition, I think we're designed to complement each other, weren't we? But in terms of commercialisation as well with the technology, you know, it's the early internet stuff with the animation, things like Tori went over, you know, there's huge potential there for us to explore those technologies. But I guess back then, it wasn't something that was a focus as what it is now. You go through universities and the lab as well. It's more of an effort to try and spin things out and things like that. Yeah.
So, do you still want to update on that legacy?
No.
We're
a tier one site, which I think means we store a big chunk of it, but it's different levels. But I'm not sure how much in the whole scheme of things we store. But
we store a copy. There are four experiments on our compiler. But UK has different levels of involvement in them, so I think we store a whole data set from Atlas and CMS, I think.
Yeah, and we do store subsets for the other two experiments as well.
So we don't take a copy of the entire data set, but we have a significant part. And it gets moved, one of those things that gets moved around constantly, so you really kind of
just
always anticipate what's where. But, sorry?
So you move the data close to people to the analysis?
Both. The Atlas data store is not just data storage. There's a significant server file in there as well. So a lot of the analysis is done locally, so you don't need to move the data. Depends on the usage pattern.
Okay. How do you remove all that massive amount of data if it is changing all the time?
There's a very fat pipe between us. There's a dedicated light path between us and the server.
Okay. So you get some new torrent downloads and whatever.
I think it's 40 gigabytes on this slide.
And then they run the super giant backbone as well. So.
Yeah, giant was something that came out of the lab as well. And
you were saying that you build this like macro storage system.
Yep.
Is there commercialization? Is there anyone else who wants to store that amount of data that you can sell the solution?
Well, we do offer the solution to lots of research organizations. I think we do with MRC, Medical Research Council, and some others. But I don't think we deal with any commercial data to deal with. It's just generally research data. We're pretty specialist in that area. And through academic networks generally the same federation, single silos and things like that, and user agreements, so it's probably easy just to stay in that domain.
Cool.
Anybody else got any questions? If not, Victoria's back and start having a look what she's brought along with her.
I bought some ferrite core memory and an Atlas circuit board and some original manuals, including the user guide.
Where should we put them? Should we put them on the table there or join? Okay, so if you want to look at any of those things, feel free to approach Victoria. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tom and Victoria, for coming to speak to us this evening. And thanks for all your extended colleagues who were able to answer some of the more wide scope questions. We're looking forward to seeing what Victoria's brought with and Victoria's produce. And some of us will probably be going down the land flag after the meeting, so if anyone wants to come along, you're very welcome for a quick drink. Okay, thanks once again.